lot of buzz about pollinators these days, and rightfully so, with so many of our food crops and commodities being dependent on pollination. But it seems like mostly we hear about maybe monarch butterflies or the honeybees, and everybody else just kind of falls by the wayside. But it's that everybody else that really makes that impact with pollination. So today, we're gonna talk a little bit about native bees. Joining us is Catherine Wells, master naturalist, here to tell us a little bit more about the differences and the importance of these awesome pollinators. Catherine, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure, always, Tyler.
Yeah, so could you go ahead and talk to us a little bit about, you know, what is the difference between honeybees versus native bees? Aren't they all just bees?
Great question. They are all just bees, but there's a big distinction between the two. So first of all, our native bees are natural to this area.
Another big difference is the honeybees are atypical from most every other bee in that they live in large colonies, whereas most of our native bees are solitary bees and 70% of them live in the ground. And I'd say probably one big difference is the honeybees, while they get a lot of press for being great pollinators, and they are pollinators, they're not as good as our native bees.
Yeah, awesome. And I love your point about, you know, honeybees being social bees versus most of the native bees being solitary. And that really impacts like some of the fear that people have around bees, right? So if somebody's afraid of bees, they might not need to be as afraid of the native bees, right? Because they're more solitary and don't have to defend anything.
Exactly. And so I would say it would be very rare for anybody to find a native bee treating them aggressively.
Yeah.
Unless you found, you know, a little bee nest in the ground and you were actively trying to disrupt it, and then they still might just fly away instead of defending it. But it would be very unlikely for someone to be stung by a native bee.
Yeah. Well, great. So could you tell us a little bit about what are some of the most common bees that we might see here in North Texas?
Sure. So there are about 4,000 species of bees just in North America. And here in Texas, we mainly see six families of bees. Some of the most common ones, some of the most who are the earliest arrivers in the spring are our mining bees. They're some important pollinators of the first crops of the year. We also see sweat bees.
Sweat bees.
Sweat bees.
That's what I am right now, sweat bees.
It's a little sweaty. We might see some out here. And some of them are actually beautiful colors. There's some that are this metallic iridescent green. So not all bees are shades of black and brown and yellow and orange. We also have mason bees. And one of my favorite mason bees is actually a blueberry color. And then another one that we see a lot, I saved it for last because it's one of my favorite, are our bumblebees.
Yep.
Yeah.
When I think of bumblebees, I think of these big fuzzy bees. And you mentioned, you know, being better pollinators. I'm guessing that being that fuzzy makes them a little bit more messy as they're pollinating.
You're exactly right. Messy's a good thing.
Yeah.
Right?
We like messy.
Messy's a good thing. So our bumblebees, as well as most all of our native bees, are hairier. Mm-hmm. And one thing that does is it gets the pollen, the dry pollen, all over their bodies. When they're going in to a bloom, they get the pollen from the anthers of a flower. They fly to another flower. That dry pollen sheds off into the stigma of that flower. And it's just very effective pollination. You might notice on honeybees, and bumblebees do this too, they have pollen pockets.
Yep.
And so it's more of like a wet pack that they're taking mostly back to their nests. And that's fine, but they're just taking it with them and they're not really distributing that among other plants.
So if we're gonna try to attract bees to our yard or to our garden area, what are some plants that we might want to include? Are there certain things to have? Are there certain things to avoid?
Sure, absolutely. Well, first of all, I'd put a plug in for native plants because our native bees have co-evolved with them over the years. Some of our native bees are specialists, meaning they'll only go to certain plants, certain blooms. Others are generalists. They'll go to just about anything that's blooming. But flower shapes are important because some of them are long-tongued, like our American bumblebees, that can really get deep into blooms that are tubular, like penstemons and salvias and that sort of thing. Others, not so much. They're short tongue, they're tiny, they need different configuration of
plants. So you really want a diversity of plants to attract the diversity of pollinators.
Exactly. A diversity of plants, a diversity of bloom times, so you've got something blooming almost all year round as well as you can. Another thing I'd say is don't be an immaculate curator of your garden. Leave a little spot natural, and natural as in bare ground, because if 70% of our native bees are, you know, nesting underground, you don't want to have to fight through mulch. They can't fight through turf grass. They can't fight through cement to get to where they're going, right? So leaving at least a little area of your garden sort of that bare ground. Some of the others that nest in logs and stumps, you have to do what's safe for your particular situation. But our carpenter bees, for example, and our mason bees and some others, will nest in woody things. And if you have a little bit of woody things in your garden, it'll keep them from maybe burrowing into your fence post or something like that.
Yeah, and that's something a lot of us don't think about, right? With the winter, we're just, you know, focused on the image and is it pretty, but we really want to be focused on, are we providing habitat for these creatures that are also important to our existence?
Exactly.
So things like leaving the leaves. I'm imagining that something you were going to go back to was reducing your pesticide use on the lawn.
Yes. Pesticides, insecticides, even fungicides, because there's a certain amount of fungus that they use in their cells, which is a healthy and a good thing. And when that's out of whack, you know, the eggs can't develop and all like that. So all the ides, even the herbicides, if you use the herbicides, that's going to kill some of the plants that bloom for them. So eliminating or at least reducing your use of the ides, it's probably the single biggest factor. Right underneath that is leaving a habitat for them so they've got a little place to call home.
Awesome. Very cool. Thank you, Catherine.
My pleasure.
We hope you guys have learned a little bit about native bees today and might consider creating some habitat for them in your own yard. To learn more, visit flower-mound.com/garden. Thanks for joining us.